There is a light that burns in the darkness. There is a hope that washes the fear away. There is a peace that settles around us. It is your love that sets our hearts ablaze. There is a light that burns in the darkness. There is a hope that washes the fear away. There is a peace that settles around us. Oh, it is your love that sets our hearts ablaze. Father, we're on our knees. With every heartbeat, we bring you this offering. Lord, come and fill this place. Father, we're crying out. Spirit, we need you now. Glorious love surrounds us. Lord, come and fill this place. There is a king that reigns in victory. There is a mercy strong. We're on our knees.
I'm singing hallelujah. Good afternoon, Gravity Church family. It's good to see you all here. If you're new to Rabbit Creek Church, welcome. We're glad you're here. We are here for one reason tonight: to celebrate, to worship, and praise our Lord Jesus Christ. Yeah. Let's do that.
Stand with us.
Well, Merry Christmas!
Merry Christmas!
How are you guys? My name's Corey. We want you to feel welcome. We wanted to take a minute and just say hi. It is great to have you here with us this evening. A couple of things. If you, on your way in, did not get a chance to pick up one of our worship folders, we would love for you to do that on the way out. If you are new to Rabbit Creek, you will find a QR code on here that you can scan, which will actually give you access to a thing called Right Now Media, which is a pretty fantastic online source of Bible study videos, but also really good videos for kids and families, and some pretty cool documentary videos and all of those things. And so just a gift to you. You just take it, you scan it, and it'll walk you through how you can set that up. So make sure you grab one of these on your way out. The other thing you saw on your way in are cups on a table. And if you've been with us for Christmas Eve services before, you know we love the thing where you walk in and the room smells like apple cider and cookies. And we decided that we could make it smell that way this year, but we still couldn't send you with anything, and then that would be mean. And then one of our small groups called and said, hey, look, we think the whole cider and hot chocolate and cookies thing doesn't need to go away. We would like to prepare cups for people to grab on their way out and take them with them and prepare them at home. And so as you leave, you grab your cup and it's got hot chocolate in it. If you would prefer cider, there are boxes of cider there. It has some non-home-baked cookies in it. And you can take and enjoy that as a family and continue the cider and cookies tradition that we have done for the last, I don't know, a lot of years. But you enjoy that. A blessing for one of our small groups we think is pretty cool. But mainly, thank you for being here. Merry Christmas. Would you continue to worship with us this evening?
Stand with us.
Thank you.
Again, Merry Christmas. As we gather together to celebrate tonight and remember the birth of Jesus, we continue this question of what are we waiting for, as we've been doing throughout the Advent season, this season of anticipation. We remember the coming of the Messiah and anticipate his return. And during the time of reflection and meditating upon what that means for us, we think about the things that we're waiting for. Big decisions, answers, some kind of clarity in our lives, waiting for big events like marriages and birth of children or big moves or whatever they may be. And talking about waiting, talking about understanding that there's always something that is tomorrow. There's always something that is coming the next day. We're going to talk today, tonight, about something that changed in a day like no other. And I want to again welcome you to this service, to be a part of this together. And I want to say a special welcome for those of you watching online as we gather here with you as well. I want you to think about some gentlemen who are living their everyday, ordinary lives. They are out in the fields, and they live in the fields because their livelihood depended on it. And their livelihood depended on it because those that they protected depended upon them. You see, these men are shepherds, and their job is to take care of the sheep and the goats, and to take care of those animals that are there for them to raise and to protect so that they can make a living for themselves and for their families. And so these men actually live in the fields with the sheep, and they protect them from predators. They give guidance and leadership to the sheep, who are often known for not being able to do that on their own. And it's just an everyday, ordinary day for them. One night goes after the other, and perhaps the only thing they're waiting for this time is for the night to pass, because when the sun rises, it's easier to see predators, and there's not so much mystery in the light as there is in darkness. And everything's the same, day after day after day, until this day. This day that will forever change them, it will forever change the history of the world, and it will make things different, not only that day for them, but for every day forward. Luke, the gospel writer, invites us into their story in the second chapter of Luke. We've been talking about these wonderful stories of Scripture that tell us the historical truth of people who've experienced God, and God coming to them in the voice of an angel or words of angel and saying to them, this is what I'm about to do. And this is another one of those angel stories. A true story of God sending an angel, a messenger, to say, this is what I have in store for you. And we will see these in Luke chapter 2 as we visit these men out in the fields at night. Luke chapter 2, beginning in verse 9. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger. Every time I read that text, I picture Linus toting his blanket. I don't know how many of you do the same. Where Linus stands before his friends and quotes the Christmas story. Now, one thing I like about when Linus does it is he quotes from an old translation of Scripture. And there's a phrase in there that really captures my attention. In the text I just read to you out of the New International Version, it says, an angel appears to them, and they are terrified. The way that Linus says it, quoting Scripture, he says, and they were sore afraid. They were sore afraid. I love that term, sore afraid. A sore afraid just has a bigger impact than me than terrified. I'm terrified that could just happen. I'm terrified by other drivers. I'm terrified by things that go bump in the night. But to be sore afraid, that's a whole different level, I think. And they're terrified because an angel has come into their presence. Now keep in mind, when angels come into people's presence in the Scriptures, we find that this is not a cuddly baby coming to say hi. Now this is an angelic proclamation. And we saw in the last few weeks, we saw the Zechariah story, how he is in the Holy of Holies, and an angel appears before him and says, God is going to give you a son through your wife Elizabeth, and he will lead the way for the Messiah. And Zechariah struggles with that. And then we saw last week Just a few days ago, last Sunday, Mary, as she is going about her ordinary day, and the angel appears into her life and changes her life from that day forward, and she too is afraid, and the angel's first words are, "Do not be afraid." Here they are afraid. And I want us to really put ourselves in their shoes for a moment and think about what is going on in their world. See, these are simple people, not unintelligent people, not less than people, but simple people. People that are ordinary people, people that would easily be passed up on the street because they're just shepherds. Shepherds don't draw attention to themselves. Shepherds don't wear clothes that draw attention. Shepherds don't wear crowns. Shepherds don't make a lot of noise. They have a job, they have a purpose, and they fulfill it. And it's in this setting that we find this great angelic proclamation. And for the purposes of our message this afternoon, I want to focus on the third sentence of the proclamation. There's a lot in that brief sentence. We're going to make four observations out of that sentence and then go from there. But here's what I want you to notice. This phrase, chapter 2, verse 11. The angel says to these shepherds, "Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord." Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. Now, we don't have to look very far for the first observation. The first observation is the first word, today. Now, you may read right past that word and think, well, so what? Today. That doesn't sound very significant. Well, let me help you understand why it's so significant. You see, these Jewish shepherds, they were Jewish by birth and by faith, which means that they would have heard from their parents and grandparents, as their parents and grandparents would have heard from theirs, that this great messianic promise, as we knew that Zechariah heard, we knew that Mary heard, that there would one day come a Messiah to set things right, the chosen one of God to redeem the people that have been in a broken world since the testimony of Genesis 3. Hundreds and hundreds of years have gone by with mother and father telling daughter and son, someday, someday, a Savior is going to come into this world. But that's not what the angel said to the shepherds, is it? They didn't say someday. They didn't say in the next generation. They said today. Today. That's a big word, folks. Today. In other words, the shepherds are still realizing at the very first word of the angel, "Do not be afraid." But then today, today. And when they heard the rest of the sentence, that today stood out to them. This is not something that is later. This is today. This is something we've anticipated, and wow, it is happening today. Next observation. We see that there are names, and each of these will be one of those observations. Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. First observation today. Second observation, his title, first one given, is Savior. Now, what's significant about that? I'll tell you what's significant about that is this is a word meaning Sator is the word there. And what that means is one who rescues, one that brings a person out of a dangerous situation and places them on a firm foundation in a safe place. They take a person out of danger and put them into peace. And the angel, who has just said, "Do not be afraid," says a Savior is coming. Today, a Savior has arrived. Now, that's a huge word because there's been conversation about a Savior from generation after generation, and they say, "A Savior's come." These people who are living under Roman rule, these people who have seen the Jewish people oppressed year after year, generation after generation, now they hear that the Savior has arrived. Third observation, first is today, second, he's a Savior, and third is he is Messiah. That's from the Hebrew word that is Messiah, which leads to the Greek word Christ. And so, depending on what translation of Scripture you may read, it may say he is the Savior and the Christ. This translation, making sure that we understand the connection between the Old and the New Testaments, uses the Hebrew Messiah. And so here is a Savior and a Messiah. What's significant about this? Well, if the angels stopped at the word Savior, they could have been generally speaking. There are many people who bring people out of dangerous situations into positive situations. There are many saviors, small s. There are people who save us from drowning water. There are people that pull us over or push us out of the way of a moving vehicle. There are people who rescue us in scary moments. There are parents that comfort us. There are people in our community that protect us. These are people that are saviors in that way. But there's a whole other savior here. This is the savior who is the Messiah, the anointed one. Now, make sure you understand that. So when the Jews heard this, Messiah, the anointed one, is what that word means, Mashiach, the anointed one. That's a royalty image, the anointed one. It's the oil of anointing. Don't think doTERRA and smell good. Think of the anointing of God upon a person who is going to be king. Today, in the town of David, a rescuer who is king has arrived. And then he goes forth further and says, today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born. He is the Messiah. He is Lord. That word is kurios, meaning Lord or sovereign. In other words, in charge. And so the one who is today has arrived, is going to be your rescuer, is going to be the fulfilled promise, the ultimate king, and is going to be your sovereign. He is going to be the one who has authority over you. Not just a general king who can save, but the king who, to whom you are to give your entire life. And so you put these observations together, and you see these shepherds who are going about their ordinary day, looking out for sheep and lion, and looking for wolf to come and devour sheep, and that's their whole focus. And that comes to a pause as the angels appear and say, do not be afraid. Today, in the historical town of David, Bethlehem, which is prophesied as the place, is a Savior is born to you, who is the Messiah, who is the Lord. Wonderful words. But then they get directions. They get the first century directions equivalent of the Google Maps. It says, here's where you go. You follow where I tell you to go. And you're going to find a baby wrapped in cloths lying in the manger. Now, you've probably heard that story 100 times or more, and it may not be very shocking to you. But let's let it shock us a minute. Today, the Savior, who is the promised Messiah, who is sovereign, is where? In a manger. Dressed in what? Rags. And is how old? A baby. Today, the town of David, a Savior is born to you. He is the Savior, the Messiah, the Lord. I want you to think about the amazement these shepherds must have felt. As you think of this, I want to share these words from Darrell Bach, who helps us dig into that a little bit. He says this. He says, Luke's remarks intend a declaration of this baby's greatness. This is why all people can be filled with joy. Jesus may be lying in an animal trough, but heaven is present at his birth. I want you to understand this, that here is a baby wrapped in cloths, lying in a manger, an animal trough. And that shocks us. That tells us God's doing something in a way that we did not anticipate. And these shepherds go and they find a simple family with a baby who looks like any other baby. Yes, it's his own fingerprints, and yes, his own look, but a human baby who looks like a human baby. Wrapped in cloths, lying in a manger. And in case you don't know, I did not know this till several years ago, embarrassed to say, but growing up, nobody ever told me that a manger was not the barn. A manger is the trough, okay? Anybody else not know that until recently? Okay, this was me until a few years ago. And I was like, oh, that makes a whole lot more sense. Here is a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a trough. Lying in a trough. And what happens is these shepherds come and they see Mary and they see Joseph. Like themselves, simple people. Not homeless and poor and not wealthy and with excess, but simple people. Day-to-day people. who when they gave offerings gave doves instead of sheep because that's all they could afford. And God chose these people to raise the Savior. And I want you to notice the beauty of that, that here is the Messiah in the flesh, and God trusts humanity to raise his son. You see, God created the heavens and the earth. He created the stars in the sky, the animals that run on the ground, the fish that swim in the waters, the birds that fly in the air. He created you, he created me, he created Alaska, he created the mountains. He created all that we see. And he could have said, poof, here's full-grown Jesus, the Messiah. But he didn't do that. He gave humanity an opportunity to help bring the Messiah to age. That here are Mary and Joseph and simple shepherds as the first recipients of the news and the first celebrants of this news that here is the Messiah. I want you to hear these words of Matthew that remind us of what's actually taking place here in this text. Matthew, likewise, telling the birth of Jesus story, gives us another name. We know he's Jesus. We know he's Savior. We know he is the Messiah of Christ. We know he's the Lord. But check this out. Matthew chapter 1, verse 23. The virgin, that's Mary, will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us. This baby that you find wrapped in simple cloths, lying in a place where animals eat, is today, in the town of David, a Savior, a Messiah, a Christ, and Lord, and he is God with us. Here's where I want you to bring some of these observations into your today. Your today and my today is not the shepherd's today, but it's our today, and their today story affects our today story. And I think what we can do to help that story make its impact in us as God would want it to is for us to spend some time thinking about those three titles given in Luke chapter 2, verse 11. I quote it again so you remember. The angel says, first of all, do not be afraid. And then he says, today in the town of David, a Savior is born. He is the Messiah, the Lord. Some of you may need to grasp today this idea of Jesus being Savior. If I grasp that he's a Savior, I mean one of two things. One meaning, some of you may need today to recognize that you need salvation in the first place. That's where the journey of Christianity begins, recognizing our need for salvation. A person does not feel like they need to be rescued from the water until they feel like they're drowning. Sometimes we're going through life at a pace that's so fast we don't pause to realize that we actually are in need of rescue, and this is where we find ourselves. So that's the first thing. Maybe you just need to realize you need salvation. Or secondly, if you've already come, like I have, to salvation, you've received Jesus Christ and you've received salvation, and then you must realize that you are still broken. You're still a sinner. And we all still need salvation day after day. And we all need to continue to cry out to God to help us in this journey of life. You see, I'm not a prophet, I'm a preacher, which means I can't tell you about tomorrow. I can speculate. I can tell you what might happen tomorrow, but I can't stand before you and say, God has told me tomorrow will look like blank. In fact, if anybody tells you that, doubt it highly. But I stand before you to say that I'm pretty sure that January 1st will not make all the craziness we certainly live in right now go away. Hope I'm wrong. But I'm pretty sure January 1st there's still going to be problems in the world. I'm pretty sure we're just to be confused about what we can and cannot do, where we can shop, where we can eat, where we can't. Where can we travel? There's still going to be sickness, there's still going to be cancer, there's still going to be hurt, there's still going to be pain. And in those moments, we need to realize we need a Savior. Today in the town of David, a Savior is born. He is the Messiah. He is the Christ, which means he's not simply a Savior. He is the promised one. And some of you need to be reminded that we're not talking about general salvation. We're talking about the promised, anointed one of God, which means he's King. And some of you need to recognize that we're talking about Jesus. We're talking about a King. You can listen to many stations on the radio or on social media and listen to wonderful songs about the baby Jesus, but many people stop at baby Jesus and don't realize we're talking about the King of Kings. And so one of the things we need to recognize in the angelic proclamation is we're talking, yes, about a baby wrapped in cloths, lying in an animal feeding trough, but we're also talking about that same child who is King of Kings. Today in the town of David, a Savior is born. He is the Messiah. He is Lord. We could all identify in our mind's eye, and if she walked in here, we could recognize Queen Elizabeth of England. She's a queen. I respect that. But I don't give my life to her. So when you hear that someone is king, don't misunderstand. We're not talking about a king just worthy of respect. We're talking about a king who is Lord. And we give our lives to this Lord. So some of you need to realize that you need to give your lives to Christ and call him your Lord. But perhaps you've done that, as I have. But we need to remember, just as we remember we need salvation day after day, is that we need his lordship day after day. And so tonight is a good night to again surrender, to again give over your life. An angel appeared to these shepherds living out in their fields by night. And they were sore afraid. The angel said, don't be afraid. Today, in the town of David, the Savior is born. He is the Messiah, the Lord. Our today, some of you are sore afraid. And I want to invite you to remember those great titles of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, that he is the Savior. That he is the Messiah, that he is the Lord. Father, we are so thankful for the promise of Scripture and the assurance of our salvation based upon the truth, God, that you sent your Son as a baby wrapped in cloths lying in a manger. He would grow into the Savior, the King of Kings, and Lord of Lords. God, we love you. We praise you. We thank you. Each Christmas Eve, as we come together and celebrate the birth of Jesus, we are reminded of the great command to spread the light of Christ, the love of Christ. That's what we do as we come to a time of candlelighting. And I want to invite you to join us in this as we celebrate the light of Christ. As you reflect upon the light of Christ, be mindful of his love for you and share that love with others. Have a great Christmas Eve and have a wonderful Christmas. Good night.